So we're all ready to go here. My name is Ulf Dahlström. I've been living most of my life in the United States of America and studied energy since a teenager, basically. And so we're going to talk about free energy. Of course, free energy is a little bit of a misnomer, but what we're talking about here is the energy conversion. So we have energy that's seemingly free, like the sun, wind, etc. And it's a matter of converting that energy into something useful. And in the past, there's different inventors that has been able to do that from the energy that we don't see, not the normal sun power, geothermal, but other types of energy. So we're going to start looking a little bit at that. Here's a quote from Schopenhauer. And this is kind of how it goes in the resistance from the paradigms that we live in. These three facets. First, it's ridiculous. Second, it's violently opposed. And then it's accepted as self-evident. Here are some quotes from the past. This is from 1895, heavier than air cannot fly. And then it was disproved just a couple of years later to show that, you know, sometimes we don't think the current paradigm is not always correct. Same thing about the atom. This is 1923. Bill Gates. And also from Einstein. No problem can be solved from the same level of consciousness who created it. It's a very good quote. Okay, so let's go back in time a little bit. This is 3,000 years ago. This is Abydos in Egypt. And this is some of the carvings here that looks pretty much like you might imagine the space shuttle or something similar like that. Here, something that looks
too fast.
Okay, we can go back. Okay, so we have this picture here. Let's go on to the next one. Okay, this is one that looks a little bit like a helicopter. You can see it here, this one and this one here. Here's a little better. So here, this looks like a tank, maybe. This could be some type of aircraft. Looks pretty much like a modern-day helicopter. And this is from 3,000 years ago or so. This is one from 1500 AD, and this was found in the Antigua province in Colombia. Looks like an insect, but some Germans thought maybe this could be some type of an airplane. So they went ahead and actually built one based on this structure, and it proved that it was actually flying better than a normal airplane aerodynamically. And this is the model plane here that was built. Then we have Patterson. He's a guy who is an expert in aerodynamics. He went to Japan. He found these Dogon statues from 6,000 years old. And according to him, this is hidden information in these statues. And as you can see up here, this is what he believed some of these things are. And based on these decoding that took him a couple of years, he built what he calls the gravitational antenna and put it on his car. And then he had this design given to other people to try it out. And around the world now, there's a lot of people building these based on his drawings and listing their results on his website. And people are getting different results, but they're all getting results with this once you come over a specific speed. This seems to create some type of vortex and some types of vacuum in front of the car that creates better mileage. Here's John Worrell Keeley. This is from the 1800s, one of the pioneers in alternative energy. He was a musician, and he thought that everything had a resonance, a frequency to it. So he invented something called vibratory physics. And based on the idea that different materials have different frequencies, and if you can put them in harmonic resonance, you can create energy. This is one of the earliest models built here. This unfortunately was stolen. It's still been stolen, but friends of mine, Dan Davison, that is also building these devices, they tested it and got it to work with very little water. That's what's used in this machine here. This is Dale Pond. he has built what's called a dynosphere based on Keeley's work, which is different spheres within spheres with specific materials. And as you can maybe see here, it's like strings here, like on a piano. It sits on a very heavy stone structure to have it balanced here very precisely. Then you have these tunes here, which is like flutes, like to make this whole thing tuned. It's very finely tuned, and they've got this thing running, and they also have it, there's like a mental component interaction with this machine as well. And he's doing a lot of research on this. This is Stubblefield, late 1800s, beginning of 1900s. He invented the first cell phone, if you will, and demonstrated it here in 1902, I think it was. And as you can see here, this is Nikola Tesla up here somewhere. There's a picture right there. He was at this experiment, and they had a wire that was hooked up to ground, and through the ground, several miles further down, they had another wire stuck in the ground, and through these frequencies that he had tuned into, they were able to speak through big distances. And here's Nikola Tesla. He's one of the main inventors in the last 100 years, invented AC, radio actually as well, plus a lot of other things. So we're going to take a little look here in a quick clip.
You'd think you'd know his name every time you switch on a light or turn on your radio. His contributions are as far-reaching as those of Albert Einstein, Isaac Newton, or even his nemesis, Tom Edison. This mysterious, tall, dark Serbian invented alternating current, wireless communication, the modern electric motor, basic laser and radar technology, X-rays, neon, robotics, remote control and cellular technology, and even Star Wars tactical warfare, all over 100 years ago. Yet today, who's ever heard of Nikola Tesla? How could history overlook such an incredible legacy? This fantastic structure was the very culmination of Tesla's vision to create a worldwide communication system for sending sound and pictures. The primary goal was to beat Marconi for the honor of delivering the world's first transatlantic wireless signal. By no accident, Tesla's grand project was to be financed by the devil himself, J.P. Morgan. The system could also electrify the world. Wardenclyffe would provide limitless, free energy everywhere for everybody.
So this project was shelved because of financial things from J.P. Morgan that withdraw it. This was supposed to be able to only not only transfer sound, but also energy transatlantic. And we could have had that today if it wasn't for that. Here we have T. Henry Morey. He built a device that was basically had an antenna, and it was also putting into ground, earth ground. And then he had some specific circuits and some specific materials that he tuned into again. It was a tuned-in radio antenna. And he could then funnel a lot of energy into this. He had an array here of 100-watt light bulbs and other things to show a load. They even took him in an airplane up into the space to see if it works outside of that as well. There's very many different scientists have been there to actually look at it, including government agencies, but nothing really came out of it. He had an infiltrator in his lab that crashed his prototypes, and after that he wasn't able to financially rebuild it. His son is now trying to do something with it, actually. Then we have Victor Schauberger. He's a former Austrian forestman, and he studied nature. He studied specifically water and the structure of water and how the water was flowing in nature. And based on those principles, he built the unit here. This is a home electric thing that goes in a circle like this. And inside of it, you have a hyperbolic structure where the water is going in its path, and created something called, he called it cold electricity. There was no batteries, but the energy was taken straight from currents in the water. He also created water troughs where they took the trees from the forest to the factory in a small trough of water. That was back in the 30s. This is John Searle. He is active even today. I think he's in his 90s right now. And he's working for what's called SEG, Searle's Energetic Motor. And this is a magnetic motor. And as you can see on the picture, we have another little thing here, I think, showing this is the animation of it. These magnets sits around and then they create this motion. And he induces that motion with a little bit of current until it starts rolling quite fast. And I think today they're on the final stages. It's got funding now in England, and they're developing this technology. And I will show also a clip here of the real prototype. They are hoping to have this in production fairly soon. Then we have Joseph Newman. He created a machine that gave over unity. In other words, gives more energy out than when you put into the machine. And he tried to get a patent on this in America and was refused one, even though he had tested it with several government agencies, etc. He took it all the way to the Supreme Court, and he lost in Supreme Court. He did get a patent in South Africa, and today he's much older, but he's working now on a big, this is a big pump that is powering, but I think 50 or 40 watts or something to crank this whole thing. And he's having that as a show model. And I'm not really sure exactly where he's right now with this thing. He's also looking for funding. Paul Bauman. This Testatica machine, this is a guy from the foundation of Methanita, which is outside of Bern in Switzerland. And this is an electrostatic machine that takes energy from the static electricity in the air. And based on my research, it seems like he's also using some type of nuclear effect from radiation from something that emits alpha particles that is part of something that's inside of the system. Here's a couple of more pictures of these units. And I've had people that has been there and testing the unit. It's a working unit, but they don't produce it to anybody outside of their community. This is Bruce De Palma. He's passed on now. I met him when he lived in Santa Barbara. And he created a magnetic motor with an over-unity effect. And Paramahansa Tiwari from India built a similar machine called the Space Power Generator. That he was using in India. Then when it comes to magnetic motors, we have Howard Johnson that was one of the pioneers with this. And he did get a patent on his magnetic motor by showing a train that was running on only permanent magnets running on a track in the courtroom. And after him, there's a lot of people that has tried to come up with magnet motors. One of these is Troy Reed. And here's a little clip. This was back in the end of the 70s, beginning of the 80s.
This is a new prototype of the magnetic motor, and if I can explain a little bit about what you call a magnetic field. All magnets, the big old wooden prototype, has a system. As the motor went over, it had a tension to jerk over like that. If you take this motor here and you take your finger and rotate it, it doesn't have that jerking in it. So what I've done, I got rid of the crankshaft, I've got rid of the injectors, and the system in this motor here, as you crank this motor up, and like you do the other one, the motor will start running, and what I'll do, I'll energize it on this motor here. If you can see these amp gauges over here, this will come, when we get it up to about 150 volts, we'll unplug it and we'll turn the light on. If you turn this around where you can see this side here, all the working parts is behind this system here, operates from a little computer. Takes just 5 volts. It's 150 volts. What we're going to do, turn off all the switches, make sure there ain't nothing plugged into it. There's the plug. There's your 110 volts. Motor still running. You can operate this table pump around. Still got energy running. Nothing tied up in the back of it. Nothing on the floor. Rotate around, still running up, running electricity.
So this is something was intending to put in the car and run car. He had a car running on this thing also. He was funded by his brother, Dennis. But as far as I know, nothing really came into production with this unit. This is two guys from Australia, and they also took and built a magnetic motor. In the end, they sold out to, I think, some Arab or something for a lot of money. But they had also a self-running magnetic motor. This is current right now. Mummer yieldis motor. He's currently building this device and try to go into production with it. He's showing his prototype in different shows in Europe and in the United States, and has been tested by the University of Delft in the Netherlands and others to produce more energy out than in the putting in this magnetic motor. A lot of magnets in there. Then we have Tom Bearden. He is developed what's called a mega motionless electric generator, which is no moving parts. It's pulsing the coils in a specific frequency again to tap into the energy field that we have all around us in the environment and creating an output. He's got a patent on that, and he is also looking for funding. Here's a little bit talk from Bearden on the ether.
The prevailing belief of the time was that the vacuum was a thin material fluid, the so-called material ether, which we know today is false. The ether is there, but it's not the observable material fluid. Faraday had re-established this notion of lines of force, but he thought the electromagnetic field, or the electromagnetic disturbances in the ether, so to speak, was really twanging strings. The strings were under tension, and when you had a disturbance, what you really did was pluck the strings. Now, Maxwell states very clearly that he set about to actually capture exactly what Faraday was doing in his lines of force in the theory, and that's what he did. Maxwell's actual theory is 20 equations and 20 unknowns in quaternions, which is a higher topology algebra. You can do things in that you can't dream of in doing in tensors, and you certainly can't do in vectors, and you certainly can't do with the theory that's taught at our universities. All that remains to be rediscovered and uncovered.
So this is something that some other people are actually working on, these solid state devices. Well, we're going to look at another one soon here. The hydrosonic pumps, I met the guy who came up with this many years ago, and it's a phenomenon that is like what's called water hammering, where water is imploding and then taking the implosion force of the water to drive an engine or create steam or heat. As far as I know, he also sold his invention to a big corporation. But here's a clip showing the cavitation effect. This is from a stroboscope, and there's like an acrylic glass here, so you can actually see it as this thing is spinning very fast. And in here, at least, you can see the imploding force of the water because of the way this thing is constructed. Now we're just going to take a look on a clip here, which shows this actual device as it was in the beginning.
What he has tried to do is to capture the intriguing effect he'd noticed in that vibrating boiler pipe and use it to create a totally new water heater, one that works without any heat source. His company now produces what amounts to a well-engineered water hammer. It thumps and smashes the water fed into it, raises the temperature to boiling point or to steam in a matter of seconds to replace household or industrial boilers. Now, they happen to call these machines pumps.
What we have is a hydrosonic pump that has a rotor located inside. It's a cylinder that has holes bored in it at specific angles and depths, ranging from a few hundred holes up to a few thousand, depending on whether we're going to make hot water or steam.
The key to the machine seems to be the number and the design of the holes in the rotor. Briggs has experimented with many different combinations to get the best results. The rotor fits tightly into a steel chamber with only a very small gap between the two. Water is fed into the gap, and the rotor is spun rapidly by a small electric motor. As it spins, the water is pummeled and hammered through the holes. In seconds, it flows out of the cylinder as hot water or steam. What's so extraordinary about such an ordinary-looking machine is the claim that it is more than 100% efficient. More energy has been measured coming out in the form of heat or steam than the electrical energy needed to turn the rotor. The term for this is over-unity. Scientifically, this is supposed to be impossible because it overturns the fundamental law of conservation of energy. It says you cannot get something for nothing. And yet, external observers claim to have measured here up to 70% more energy out than in. A Griggs machine has been heating the water for Albany Fire Station for over a year.
This is a commercial
right
installation.
Right after our initial installation, we measured the output with Jim's team, representatives from a local university, one of our local power companies, and we were all astounded with the output. Our measurements indicated that the system was more than 100% efficient, which is very hard to believe. The average engineer would say baloney. But our measuring devices were certified, and, you know, until someone comes along and proves us different, we will say that it is more than 100% efficient.
So this is an installation that exists still today in this fire station. Then we have John Dudini, is still working on his devices, and a lot of this is open source. People can find drawings and try to replicate these experiments on the internet. This is also a type of magnetic motor that pulses a field that creates a sharp spike in the electromagnetic fields and pulls back what's called back EMF and then takes that energy and puts it into a battery or some type of a condensator. And here we will see a little clip where he explains this.
Example. If you just put this battery to another 12-volt battery, you can only divide the charge between the two batteries. So therefore, you have two lower batteries. But in this thing's case, this 12 volts right here is only to trigger this. What comes out of here is the radiant spike, which is about 4 or 5 times over this battery. See, because now this battery... Yeah, in other words, it's charging it with no current, basically. And you can see the battery has charge in it because it's barely flicking. So even if we stop the motor, see, the battery's going to go down to its original voltage. If we start the motor, you can see the pulsing process starts and the lights start to grow brighter. So where is this energy, right? Where's this energy coming from? Well, it's coming from the collapsing magnetic fields, right, which produce a radiant spike. And see, most engineers would take this circuit and short that out because it's not necessary. So they throw away the radiant. That way, if they throw away the radiant energy and don't capture that radiant energy, what happens to this battery is it just gets depleted. Since radiant energy doesn't care, you might as well just stack up as many batteries as you can and charge them all, since it doesn't care how many there are. That's why all the machines I've always shown have shown one primary battery and 4 parallels behind it. You know, at any point in time when my primary is exhausted, I can pull one out of the 4 and put it back there and insert the other one back in. I can loop this system. And this is without closing the loop.
So, in essence, what he's saying is that you have one small battery, and then you can have 4 or 5, whatever amount of batteries next to it. And then going through this machine, it actually uses that one battery to run the generator that creates these spikes into the environment. He pulls that energy into the other batteries and charging them. And as that first battery gets depleted, he can then switch to another battery and then charge the other ones as he's running the motor. And this is something that, again, if you want to probe some of this, there's something called it's a bicycle wheel circuit you can get on the internet to build yourself a small device to check it out. Dog Consen, a guy that has built a replica of this kind of a Bedini system.
You have a little motor right here. Now, the way the motor works, it's a pulse motor. So what you're doing is you're turning it on, making this electromagnet have power, so it pushes the magnet away. So what I'm doing here, if anybody wants to know the circuit, is I take the battery, put it into the coil, and then just before it gets to ground, I put a switch on it, so it turns on and off. And here's the switch right here. It's a magnetic read switch. It's a switch that's controlled by a magnet going by it. This flame that happens inside this reed switch has a lot of power to it. It should have as much power in there going in as coming out, because every time that coil turns off, all the energy contained in the coil comes kicking back. Now, you can take that energy that kicks back and put it into a second battery and charge up a second battery. So now, there's this flame here, and to make it vanish, conventional electric motor builders will just ground it out or something. But what you want to do is you want to put a full wave bridge rectifier. It's this component you can get at Radio Shack for $1.50. It changes AC into DC. Look at that baby go. Here's the battery being charged here. Watch the volts on it. See, look at this. 12.65 already. 12.66. See, it's going up. And it's going to go all the way up. It's going to go all the way up to 14 if you want. So a few days ago, I ran this motor for 50 hours. And I rocked the batteries forth. I switched them back and forth about 3 or 4 times. And at the end, I still had like 12 point something volts. And I could have gone a lot longer. So what this is it's a motor. I call it an over-unity motor, in that you're using so much power and you're always charging up another thing. So you always have a stack of batteries being charged when you run out of your batteries on the other side of the system. It's like the simplest thing in the world. And it's a motor, which means you can turn a generator with it. Now all the electricity the generator makes is free. Or you can turn a water pump with it, or anything you want, or a car. You can stack these. You can make 12 on a shaft if you want. So that's what I'm looking to have, is like a commercial unit people could buy in a store, something like this. Just something that runs on car batteries, charges car batteries, and you have excess power with a generator to do whatever you want with. So
that's another example of a Bedini motor. Then we have the Kepe motor. It's a guy from Brazil. He's actually a psychologist, but he wrote a book called The New Physics Derived from a Disinverted Metaphysics. And that looks at the physics in a different way than we do today. And these two guys here, they took that material and created a motor based on those concepts, and found that they got an over-unity motor also, a very efficient motor. They used it for fans, and they are now have built a center in Brazil where they are developing this, and actually has started production as far as I know. This is Andrea Rossi. He's very popular right now. He's developed something that's referred to as LENR, low emission nuclear reactions. He called it ECAP, as a catalytic process, where you have two different elements, a hydrogen and a nickel. And this is what they believe is happening. You put a specific amount of energy into this unit and it creates much, much more energy out. This has been measured by different universities in Europe, and is now in negotiations to bring this thing to market. So here's a couple of other smart ideas in more conventional things. This is a sun cube, or what's called a Fresnel lens. So instead of just having a normal photovoltaic cell or passive solar system. This, of course, needs to have a lot of sun. But this is basically how it works. The sun comes in and then focuses into a specific area. And then you have, in this area, a thing that converts that heat into electricity. And then you can use that electricity to, and also the heat energy to heat water, for instance. This is something that also BMW and Mercedes is working on right now, to take the heat from the exhaust system on the cars and convert it to electricity and bring it in to power your electronics in the car and the lights, instead of having a generator to take it from the engine to save on fuel. And then you can put this into the grid. So here's an example here of a guy that built one of these.
This is a very standard prototype solar furnace made of a Fresnel lens from an old recycled big screen television. I've placed it in an aluminum frame, and at near the focus here we have a heat collector and a heat exchanger we can run water through to generate high pressure steam. We can generate approximately 1.2 kilowatts of heat energy from this lens, which is about 60 inches in diameter, using nothing but sunlight. This is a basic illustration of one of the solar thermal generators I've come up with. The idea is to take the heat of the sun and use it to generate electrical power as well as hot water for a sustainable home. Here we have standard solar heating panels that create hot water that runs anywhere from 160 to 180 degrees Fahrenheit, depending on how hot it gets. The hot water carries a great deal of energy to the focus of a Fresnel furnace. This lens captures about a kilowatt or more of electrical of sunlight power and flashes this hot water into steam at high pressure. That high pressure steam operates an electrical generator. We recover the hot water, which goes to a hot water storage system like a cistern or any regular hot water tank, and you get electrical power out of it. We're getting about 60% electrical conversion efficiency, and the hot water is a free bonus. So you can put a number of hot water collecting panels on your roof, and the heat of the sun can be used not to create just hot water, but also electrical power as well with high efficiency.
How much power will this system produce?
We're targeting about 6 kilowatts of electrical power in about 10 square meters of roof space.
And how many bedroom homes can you run with that?
Well, most homes draw about 30 kilowatt hours of power a day. 5 hours of this operation would run a standard home. However, with 6 kilowatts in one of the Earth ships, which are far more conservative, you'd have more electrical power than you'll ever need.
And what about recharging an electric car? Is 6 kilowatts enough to do like a 3-bedroom home and recharge an electric car?
If you're in a very conservative home, yes, you can easily recharge a car. Nothing prevents you from putting more of these panels on the roof and collecting more energy. We can use this for heating by running the hot water through the floor if you have a radiant heating system. We can use it for lighting by using fiber optics to pipe the light inside your house so you don't have to cut holes in the roof to get the lighting inside.
And affordability?
We're looking at a payoff of 3 to 5 years, about $6,000 to $8,000 for a system like this.
So there's one innovative way of doing things with the sun. Then there is a couple of guys from MIT. They created a situation where you can harness the sun energy in the sides of the window. So you have a regular window, and the sides of the window, you get the photovoltaic action, or similar to photovoltaic action, without expensive material. And then by incorporating this in a house, they're looking at, I think, 50% or so better efficiency as a normal solar cell. Then we have ceramic paint that's been around for quite some time. This is based on the technology from the space shuttle that has a really good insulating capacity. And this you can now buy, and you can mix it with regular paint or have it pre-made. And it's got a lot of advantages compared to regular paint. So you can have it on a car for insulation or a house. You can paint it on the inside or the outside. And it's a very cheap way of having a really good insulation. This is a guy in Germany. He has come up with the concept of combining wind power and solar power with a specific material that he has developed. And we're going to see a little video where he explains it here.
Revolutionary applications for solar energy.
Our fluoropolymer encapsulation technology with a fluoropolymer surface enable us to impress in the surface our dendrite structure in the nanometer design. We are absorbing light from all angles. The light is directed onto the solar cell. That means we get a higher efficiency of the daily output or the year output. The second point is that with this dendrite structure, the surface is dirt rejecting and self-cleaning. In 95, I started to integrate photovoltaic into architecture, especially in solar tiles. We integrate photovoltaic in architecture as solar tiles, as solar slates, as solar shingles, or as solar walls.
Byrne discovered that by using his encapsulation techniques, specific types of solar cells can now be curved, opening up the application to lay solar cells onto powerful 3D surfaces. Byrne recognized that he could now integrate solar and wind generation, but for him, that was not enough. He turned his attention to reconceptualizing wind turbines to eliminate their liabilities, optimize their productivity, and make them beautiful. Manufacturing. With the new modifications of the bay door design entering into the manufacturing process, Blue Energy expects several models in production by summer 2007. Model sizes are being designed from 2 kilowatts for a home to 5 kilowatts for a large home or small business, and 8 kilowatts for commercial and industrial application. Electricity can be produced simultaneously by both the wind-turned generator and the solar cells. It can generate electricity on a calm, sunny day or at night with only a light breeze, starting at 4 miles per hour. And even during violent storms, it's power rated at winds up to 90 miles per hour. Ground installation is optimal, requiring only a small crew and no crane. An inverter is included in the self-contained unit, delivering 120 and 240 volt alternating current into a building or net metered directly into the electrical grid.
So there's another interesting application of new wind technology. Here's NanoSolar. It's a company out of California has developed these very thin material that has like a coating similar to paint that would convert solar energy into electricity. They have a plant in Germany now where they're cranking these out, and I think the waiting list is like a year now to get these things. So here's a little clip explaining that technology.
California-based NanoSolar is one of the pioneers in this field. Instead of making solar cells on bulky, expensive silicon wafers, the company has developed a light-conducting ink that's spread on a material that looks like foil.
What we've developed are inexpensive techniques based on printing.
Chris Eberspatcher is one of the lead researchers.
On your left is a piece of bare metal foil. On your right is a piece of foil that has been coated with a thin semiconductor layer to convert sunlight directly into electricity.
It's thin, flexible, and here's the key. It rolls off the presses in long strips.
What we're headed toward are large non-vacuum printing technologies. And the right mental image is one of a large printing press, for example, like newspaper printing.
The strips can then be cut to any length and stuck to roofs, sidewalks, you name it.
And again, this is something that you could apply to a car, house, or a boat, or anything. This is a guy also from America that created a unique type of hydroelectric power.
This unit here is a no-dam turbine for generating electricity.
So 100 kW would run like 30 homes, you know, roughly.
Right.
You know,
about 30 homes.
Just this little unit here.
Just this little unit here.
So you don't need to dam up.
Yeah. So you don't need a dam. Who needs a dam anymore? It's just millions of dollars that going down the river for no use.
Damn the dam.
Damn the dam.
Great, wow. So you can scale this up to any size you want.
This can be built to whatever, it can be designed and built to whatever requirements we've got of the water.
You could even do 100 megawatts.
Right. Now, it can also be modified internally to run off compressed air or to run off steam. So we got a steam turbine, air turbine, or a water turbine, all in one unit.
Wow.
It has four different ports, to this side, to the other. With the flow of water, we maintain a given pressure. Maintaining that pressure, we've got a 25%, 50%, 75%, and 100% of power. It's the only one in the world that can do this. On top of that, it inside here, it's got two stages. Now, all turbines are normally of one type: cross flow, reaction. Oh, what's the other type? Can't think of it. But it's three types of turbine there. This combines three different turbines inside, and the latest technology are thrust tubes, both in here and within the turbine. So we use the water twice instead of once. And turns this, we can take off-the-shelf generators and couple it to this, and by the volumes of water we allow through here, we'll determine the RPM. So no matter what generator you tie to this, we can calibrate this here to suit the generator that is off the shelf. Discharge is down the bottom here. We can pick that discharge up, back in the pipe again, run it down, and pick it up on another turbine when we've built a given amount of pressure, another one of these, and these can run in stages all the way down. We do not have to build a dam anymore and flood hundreds of thousands of acres of ground and taking that ground out of production. This will take care of it.
So basically, this take away the requirements to have a big dam or lake. All you need to do is to have a slope where the river comes down in a specific angle, and then you can put these in, very efficient system. So now we're getting into the stuff I've been working, which is water. Can we use water as fuel? Here's a short clip from Stan Meyer, which is the guy I worked with.
He is currently modifying a beach buggy to run on nothing but water. It doesn't have a petrol tank or even a hydrogen container. It has just a tank of water. He's invented a device called a water splitter to replace the spark plug. As the water is injected into the engine, Meyer claims it's fractured into hydrogen and oxygen, and then burned as fuel. Meyer is working on a kit to modify any engine. He hopes to demonstrate it on this car within 12 months.
And of course, the blessing to the use of the water as a fuel source, that on combustion, the byproduct is water mist. So we're even solving the environmental pollution problem at the same time that we're using water to maintain the industrial basis of the world.
So here's a couple of pictures from my time with Stan. This is Stan Meyer, his twin brother, Steve Meyer, and this guy is Rick. He had this plane, which is an Alaskan Bushmaster, that was retrofitted with the Mazda car engine, rotary engine, that we wanted to also retrofit with running on water. That's me there in the car. Again, in the car. We had a small airport where we were allowed to do tests on. We also had some airplanes. There's the airplane again with Rick. So here, this is a small jet aircraft which has injectors that could easily be retrofitted for running on water. We had a stock Corvette also, and this is Rick's airplane with the rotor engine. And this again is the car there. It's another picture of the car. Here's the electronics. Back then, we tried to come up with the different electronics to run together with the engine's cycle for firing. There is the water tank. Another picture of the water tank. This is the gas processor right there that modifies the gas and adds the different things to the water. Here's a filter for, not a filter, but this, there's two stainless steel things on each side here, right and left. And basically what he was doing is pulsing the water molecule in between the two. And when you do that really fast, then the kinetic energy creates heat that then heats up the water to the temperature you want, so it won't freeze in the wintertime without using any chemicals. Okay, so here's the replacement of the spark plugs with these water fuel cell injectors. This big red one is the water inlet, and then you have the voltage that comes in here in very high pulses. Here's a couple of pictures of the injectors. And here's a cross-section of one of those injectors where the different gases are mixed, and then this is an insulated thing here, and then it ignites through the pulse of the voltage that is regulated from the electronics. He also created electric polarization units called this system here. It's basically a hollow structure, like a donut, and on the inside it's like a very reflective surface, like glass. And in the first prototype here, he used an electric motor to run the turbine to move the gas. And the gas he created is a magnetic gas. And so then when the magnetic field is moved through the copper lining on the outside, you get two-phase and three-phase electricity. In the later stages, he came up with an electrostatic filter. And then the last one was just using optical light, an LED source, very little input of energy, to excite the electrons in the magnetic gas. And then it creates a sine wave that gets the thing to work without any moving parts. Here's a couple of different pictures of this. This is like an electrostatic one here. And this was the last thing he worked on. And this is a home heating unit where he would use a similar technology to in the car where you heat up the water, which takes milliamps, very little current going into it, and heats up the water to whatever temperature, and then you just have to circulate it through your house. Here's another picture of the prototype for the home heating unit. And this, after he took out and released the hydrogen and the oxygen from the water, he then took the hydrogen atom and created something called an electron extractor sink. When you pluck the electron from the hydrogen, then the proton tries to stabilize by grabbing another electron. And when he prevents that, then the proton goes in a very unstable state. And what happens, you get an implosion. And it's a controlled implosion, and to just get an idea of what this thing can do, you have to get this to the patent office from section 101, which means you need to prove a working prototype. And he's estimated that the equivalent value of 1 gallon of water, 3.8 liters of water, to give you an idea, it would be about 144,000 gallons of oil, so a very high energy yield in this process. Here's a guy from New Zealand that created something with water for a motorbike.
We are taken to an Auckland warehouse to check out Steve's water fuel.
And basically what we've got is just an internal combustion engine. It was a Suzuki motorcycle. It's a 350cc engine, carburetor, fuel tank, fuel.
Okay, so it looks like water.
It is. It's a water-based fuel. What we're doing is just tipping some in here. Yep. Yep. And what we're going to do is put a lid on there.
Right, so that's for me to hold.
That's for you to hold, please.
Because we're going to test this later on.
And I'm going to just tip it in here, which is a fuel tank. And then what we'll do, I'm just going to get you to stand back for a moment. And then what we're going to do is stand back a bit and crank this up. Come on, baby. Go for it. Ride it around, be nice to it.
What did I just say?
You saw a bike run on water, on a water-based fuel.
People would say that you're joking.
Yeah.
It can't happen.
They're entitled to their opinion. And that's at the end of the day, it doesn't matter what someone says, it's happening.
So it's water, you've changed the structure of the water, but you haven't added anything, like there's no hidden petrol in
no,
here?
No, there's no petroleum, no carbons, no.
Steve Ryan says the fuel is the invention. There's nothing particularly new about the bike, apart from a simple modification of the carburetor.
These two here?
So we got an independent mechanic to check it out, Steve Mason from Albany Toyota.
Well, there's no alternative fuel supply anywhere, actually, because it's all going in straight into the top here. So there's, for one, there's no room to put anything else.
So, Steve, in your experience with this bike, you've said that there's nothing unusual about it. What would you say if we said that he's putting basically water in here?
Well, without seeing it, I wouldn't believe it for a start.
So is Steve Ryan's fuel one that could change the world? Or is he carrying out some sort of elaborate hoax? Just last week, he decided he would give us a bit more of a clue about how he makes his fuel.
Yes, it's New Zealand water.
Sweet. So what we're going to do is we're just going to... I'll hold it,
yep.
And you can just tip it in.
The water goes into this box and 20 minutes later it comes out the other end.
You put these two wires together.
Yep, a couple of wires together.
We were allowed to look inside to observe the secret process, but weren't allowed to show you. We can confirm there was no hidden battery, no electricity, no sign of any other liquid. Put it into the little tank, which is definitely empty.
Yep.
So, in it goes.
I poured the fuel into the bike and then saw the bike drive off.
So there's another example of a water power. Here's a third one. This is a guy, his name is Omasa, he's in Japan. He has come up with a way of creating what I refer to as a secondary gas from an electrolytic process. And he's using a system of exciting the water at a specific frequency to create this, and then being able to store this gas. And let's just show a clip on this as well here.
This is the electric generator. Use of this new type of fuel called hydrogen oxygen gas can reportedly cut electricity costs, but can also drastically reduce carbon dioxide emissions.
We aim to cut down on CO2 by introducing this generator in all 9 of our buildings.
Japan Techno developed it. The firm is based in Tokyo. Ryushin Omasa, the president, has 22 employees. Its core product is the super vibration agitator, used for plating. When water is decomposed by an electric current using this agitator, many tiny bubbles made up of oxygen and hydrogen are generated. Omasa wondered whether this gas could be used as a fuel. Because there's oxygen, it's possible to burn without air, and there will be no CO2 emissions. Professor Masahiko Tsuchiya of Tokyo Metropolitan University is currently working on the structural analysis of this gas. It burns when oxygen and hydrogen react, and a chain reaction usually sets off an explosion. With hydrogen-oxygen gas, however, as there are many clusters of water molecules, they prevent the chain reaction.
Since it prevents the chain reaction explosion of oxygen and hydrogen, this gas is promising as an extremely stable fuel.
Now, experiments are being conducted to use hydrogen-oxygen gas as fuel that can be treated safely. In a study done this year with Tokyo University of Marine Science and Technology, the research team succeeded in making a car that runs on fuel made from a 50% hydrogen-oxygen gas combination and LP gas.
great expectations are pinned on the tiny bubbles generated from water.
タンクに溜めた酸素素ガスを燃料に小型エンジンを動かすことができた。空気の取り込み口は塞いでいる。ガスの中に酸素があるため、燃焼時に空気中の酸素が必要ないからだ。水からできた燃料のため、燃焼後はまた水に戻り、有害な排ガスは発生しないという。
非常に安定な圧力を加えても爆発しない。インフラとして整備して自由に給油で、給ガスができるような状況が作れれば。
So, as you could see there, it was running a small engine completely from this gas. And it's my belief that you could also run the car not just on 50-50, but 100% of this gas. And as far as I know, you can use existing cars, the eco-fuel cars that runs on biodiesel or LPG, and you could just use the tanks that's already there and use this gas. And one thing more I wanted to mention is that they've had 5 independent universities studies from Japan showing that when this change occurs, the actual angle of the water molecule is changing from, I think, 115 or whatever degrees it is to 180 degrees. And this is what keeps it stable and not exploding under pressure when you have it in a container. So like he says here, it's a very safe gas. Then there's a guy in California. His name is Rafael Morgado. He's come up with a very small engine that you can run on eco-fuels, but it's very, very powerful. He's right now in pre-production, I think.
My name is Rafael R.G. Morgado. I am the inventor of the Mighty Engine. That's spelled M-Y-T, means massive yet tiny. The single row cylinders configuration, which is 32 cylinders, or equivalent of, is 850 cubic inches. We have a back-to-back version, which is equivalent to 64 cylinders, that is 1,700 cubic inches, hence the word massive, yet tiny. In reference to the physical size, it's 14 inches across, 14 inches deep. Now, this engine replaces the 5 feet long, 4.5 feet tall, 2 feet wide, 3,000 pound big rig engine. If you guys are seeing the big rigs, that is the engine. So basically 3,000 pounds will be replaced by 150 pounds. They're the same displacement, 850 cubic inches, 850 cubic inches, except that's only 6 pulses or 6 cylinders, massive 6 cylinders. This is 32 pulses, all right? So basically, unfortunately, I don't think you will see this in under the hood of your car. The car manufacturers will not give you 850 cubic inches. It's just too much power, right? This will be the size of the engine of your car. We take out your V6, your V8 engine, remove about 800 pounds. We give you back 25 pounds at this measurement, 4.5 inch diameter across, 7 inches long. We give you back 25 pounds. We give you 200 to 500 horsepower in performance. If you want fuel economy, as long as you run diesel or biofuel, which we recommend, because it's the only fuel that we have run where you don't need to change oil. The same fuel lubricates the engine, hence no change oil, okay? And it's cleaner. The farmers of America can plant this fuel, okay? Now, I guarantee, if you do that, I guarantee 150 miles to a gallon, because we still have not taken into account what happens when we remove 800 pounds from your vehicle. That's still wide in the open, right? Now, we all know that a V12 engine will always make more pulses than a 4-cylinder engine. We've got about 30 cylinders in this package. Now, let's get back to the prototype. This is prototype number one. The actual design, the only job it needed to do was to prove the theory, okay? But since the internal components of this engine is already under the hood of your car, in other words, nothing brand new, just configured in a different way. So it's proven for the 100 years, I just configured it in a different way. So it has a very, very high mechanical efficiency rating, over 100 years of development, right?
So basically what he's saying, that little thing he shows, that little cylinder, would replace your entire engine in the car, that small, and give you between 200 and 500 horsepowers. and at minimum 150 miles to the gallon. And as far as I know, he's in pre-production of this right now, so that could be, who knows if it goes on the market, but it's very promising technology. Then we have the gate motor from Paul Pantone, and these are drawings you can get on the internet. They look similar to this. Shows you how you can build one yourself from a lawnmower or a small engine. In general, you can put pretty much any fuel you want into the thing, and it takes away all the pollution. And if you put it in a car, it usually gives you somewhere between 20 and 30% better mileage. Here's a little test that was done in a conference I was in Albuquerque a couple of years ago.
Okay.
What, you got some coffee?
So try the coffee.
Coffee?
Hope it doesn't make the engine too jittery.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Here you go.
Nice and bubbly.
Hey, nice and bubbly.
Dump that right in there. Now we got a crude mixture of all three in there.
So that's coffee and 7-Up and a little bit of regular fuel. No exhaust. So I've been to some workshops and actually pulled this engine apart, put it back together, put all the stuff in there and run it myself, and the stuff really works. It's really cool. The guy got into mental prison for several years, got out now, and but now he's up and running. He's doing workshops around, first ones in Europe was here just a few months ago, and they're setting up in Australia and different places now for people to either buy or learn how to use this. This is something else that's very popular right now, and it's called HHO boasters. That's where you do an electrolytic process of water and take the gas that comes out from that and add it to the combustion of your car or a motorbike or whatever. And these you can buy kits on the internet, or you can build your own. Here's a clip of one system that's been in use in Wisconsin.
Officials continue looking into hydrogen as an answer to cutting fuel costs. Tests started last fall. Rock County reporter Brad Jameson tells us with the new technology, the city has some high hopes for the future.
What we're going to try and do is displace as much fossil fuel as possible.
Since Beloit started looking into hydrogen boosters in November, everything has changed.
The electronics controls were not available at that time, and now, I mean, it's almost unheard of to buy one of these units without full electronic controls.
The new generation of boosters still uses electricity to separate water into hydrogen and oxygen and burn hydrogen for fuel. But the addition of electronic controls and computers means a more reliable system.
The operator gets in, starts it up, and goes. There's nothing to adjust. It adjusts automatically.
Right now, our fuel budget's roughly $710,000. And if we see a 25% savings in fuel, it'll be a little over $177,000 in savings.
Officials say a savings of 25% could be modest. One prototype could do far more for heavy-duty machinery.
In theory, we could reduce our fuel consumption by 90% on one of the big garbage trucks if this works the way it's designed.
If the boosters work, the city will try to equip all 163 vehicles in its fleet for about $400,000.
If we could, you know, take advantage of some of the stimulus money that the new administration's put out, we hope to pay for most of that.
Officials are looking to determine what grants could qualify, but grant funding could still be a long way off.
We're definitely going to get the ball rolling. We collect some of the preliminary data and go from there.
In Beloit, Brad Jameson, WISC News 3.
And Brad tells us the boosters not only increase performance, but officials say it also improves emissions. Now, in one truck, hydrocarbon emissions drop to 0 parts per million when the system is up and running.
So this is something anybody could really do today if you're a little mechanically inclined. These are other things you can do. You can get 100% pure acetone and add it to your tank when you fill up in the right proportions, and that will give you a better combustion as well. This is the Firestorm plug that was blocked from some of the big corporations, but here's just a little clip on how that works.
Welcome to the Nightly Automotive Report. I'm John McElroy. Cars and engines have changed a lot over the last 100 years, but not spark plugs. Yet, a local inventor has come up with a new design for spark plugs that allow an engine to run at a 24-to-1 air-fuel ratio. Today, engines run at a 14.7-to-1 ratio. By running an engine with a lot more air, the inventor claims fuel economy can improve by 40% and emissions can drop by that much. And as our Laurel Hess explains, he does it with spark plugs.
They're called Firestorm spark plugs. They're the brainchild of Bob Krupa of Farmington Hills-based Century Development International Limited.
The technology is the difference in the configuration of the bottom or the power end of the plug. It fires better, it's going to last longer, and in general, it's a change that's been wanting to come for years and years and years.
Krupa says another big advantage of the Firestorm spark plugs is that they are environmentally friendly. They almost eliminate emissions, and they drastically increase miles per gallon. This is a slow-motion view of exactly what the Firestorm plug looks like compared to a conventional plug.
The plug that you're looking on the right side is the standard spark plug. It has platinum on the center and platinum on the ground. The one on the left side is the new design Firestorm plug. Both are given identical voltage and current, and they're fired in a pressure chamber under nitrogen, and that's the way it runs in the engine, and that's the way you see it.
Krupa says when you fire a regular plug, it's like turning on a pen light. When you fire a Firestorm plug, it's like turning on a spotlight. He installed the plugs on this T-Bird. Before the new plugs, the vehicle got 23 miles to the gallon. After the Firestorm plugs were installed, he says, the car got 33 miles to the gallon, a 44% increase.
It's going to help the lawnmower industry. It's going to help CAFE. It's going to help emissions, EPA. In general, it's something that's been coming and coming and coming for years, but it's finally here.
For the Nightly Automotive Report, I'm Laurel Hess.
So my understanding is that he went to Ball and some of these big developers of spark plugs, and when they tested his plug, they said it was too good. So they decided not to manufacture it. So he's been trying to raise capital to get his own plant together, which takes a lot of money. As far as I know, he's not been successful with that yet. Here's something else that is available, condensator system. On all cars since 1964, there is a recycling system, positive crankcase valve is called in English. It's where the exhaust of the oil particles from the engine comes out and then it's returned back into the engine. And that clogs up the systems and gives you bad mileage, etc. So this basically takes that problem and puts that excess, the heavier oil particles of excess goes into this container that can be emptied, and the lighter ones recycles back into the engine with the result that you get cleaner emissions and a better running engine. And then we have nano-ceramic metal treatment systems. There are some here in Germany and some in the US. And what they do, they coat the interior metal surface of the engine and makes it much slicker. There's less resistance, which means you get better compression, takes away these cracks from the rings inside of the cylinder, also gives you better combustion. The water torch is from George Weissman from Eagle Research in Canada. He is one of the ones that developed the HHO system based on Brown's gas. After Yul Brown passed away, etc., he picked it up and created a very efficient system. And this is the one where you can use it for a lot of applications. And this neutralizing atomic waste is the big hot potato. His dad was a nuclear scientist, and they've been proving this in two nuclear plants in Canada that they can do this. But it's a big business of containing nuclear waste. So here's just a little example of this torch that runs on water, and it adapts to the element which you're using it for when you are welding. And so you can cut in tungstens, for instance. This is a very, very hot normally temperature to do. It adjusts that. You can hold your fingers like you did there, won't burn yourself. It's a cold process. Put your hand through it, won't burn yourself. And yet you can drill through tungsten. And that's basically the same thing. You can put it in water, the flame doesn't heat up, and it returns to water. And that's basically the same process that you can use in the car for creating this gas, and you can pump it and ignite it, and then you can use it to weld and cut and all these kind of things. And this is another fun thing that's available right now. It's a little stick that you can buy. You can stick it in your backpack or in your car. And all the movements creates kinetic energy that charges this thing. And then you can charge your cell phones and small things as you're running around. So this is pretty much it for this presentation. This is just a couple of thoughts to end with. So this is what it takes to start doing some changes in this direction, I think. All right, thank you. If there's any questions, then we have 15 minutes or something, or, yeah? Some of them are. I know four people myself that is not here anymore, but some of these other technologies, they're still here, some of them. Anybody else? Yeah?
Did you ever see the Stanley Meyer car run on water, or yeah, drove it yourself?
Well, what happened is the old system he had on the water was under pressure, and that's what you saw in the original movies of Stan Meyer, where they were putting it together. The second stage of the water car was what he's using the injectors, and I was part of it helping him to develop that, but I left him before that work was finished, so I didn't get to see that part working. But I did see that the water thing is working, and also I was conducting the experiments for investors where we're using different technologies to show how it works, and I'm definitely convinced the stuff is working. Anybody else? No more questions? Yeah?
What is your opinion? Why is there any investors in this?
I think there is some investors. Investors are interested in new type of technology. Some of the problems that I see is that we have a paradigm where these technologies doesn't work on the normal principles of physics as we know them today. But as I showed in the beginning here, we didn't believe that you could fly an airplane either, because that was not what we believed at the time. So when somebody has a unique device that's working, then investor comes in, they look at the device and say, wow, this is amazing, this thing is working, I want to invest in it. But before he puts money in to invest in it, basically what he does is, okay, I need to have a third opinion. So he contacts a university or some professor that knows physics to come and look at it. They look at it and they say, well, this cannot be, because it's not conforming to the normal physics. And then the investor, gets cold feet and goes out. That's one scenario. Other scenarios are that they got to a point, and then they either get bought up or they get threats, etc. Depending on the implication of the technology. There's been, other than Stan Meyer, there was people in Japan and also New Zealand that had cars running on water, and you could even, there was reportage about it, and then you don't hear anything about it anymore. And so the oil industry, the energy sector, is the biggest sector in the world for money. So it's a very powerful sector, and they want, I think, to a large degree, still keep control. That's my view. Anybody else? Yeah?
Was it in the Bologna case, they saw that they got other materials after getting energy? Then that mean it's a cold fusion.
Are you talking about the ECAT from Rossi?
Yes.
What's the question again?
then you can, it can go into the tradition of physics because it was called fusion.
Yeah, I mean, he himself doesn't call it cold fusion. Other people refer to it as cold fusion because I think there is some kind of nuclear reaction happening that converts this into heat energy that they've measured. So again, at this point, this is what they believe it is. But they have independent studies showing that there is an excess of energy coming out of this machine.
Okay, more questions. But in the Stanley Meyer case, you never checked the outcome. Was it the same water that you put in? Or were there some changes?
You mean if the water's quality and properties were the same in the exhaust after burning it? Or
after burning, yeah.
Yeah, it comes. It returns to steam and comes and converts back into regular H2O. Yes.
Because in the Japanese case, they discuss about T for LR linear forms and those with 105 degrees, and I have seen good work on that one. That there are two types of water molecules, and they are different in energy size.
You're talking about the Umasa case now?
Yes.
Yeah, it's different. That's different from what Stan was doing. It's a different type of gas.
Have you more report in paper on those molecules, 105 degrees and the linear one?
Yeah, that basically in his process, when he takes the water through his process, it changes the angle of the molecule to 180 degrees. That's what I understand from a friend that I talked to that's been involved with Umasa. And then nobody would believe him in the universities in Sweden. So he then got papers from Umasa from Japan where they had an independent studies showing that it actually is 180 degrees stable. And after that, they were then interested to conduct some experiments in Sweden. And because of what happened in this specific case, it broke up the investment with this company in Sweden. But the guy worked with him for a year and a half. So yeah, that's what I'm told. I haven't seen the papers myself, but that's what I'm told.
I have a question regarding the plasma motor or engine. As we saw, it was it ran on almost everything. As I saw it, it was a mixture of coffee and 7-Up, and it indicated that everything could be used, actually. But how do you explain that it takes a full combustion to make no exhaustion, and still you'll have some particles, I guess. How do you explain the principle behind it?
Well, they have theories because even the inventor himself doesn't really know, but they have done some testing. He has these rods within the rods, and the theory is that it creates this cracking effect. A lot of heat is applied to the fuel. So if you have fuel like, say, benzene and diesel, they have different evaporation and burn points. So the benzene will burn before the diesel. And if you have things like ketchup or coffee, whatever, they also have water and other liquids in there. And the water can also convert. But some of the stuff that does not convert, it settles as a residue in the container or the tank, so that will not get burned. But what gets burned seems to be a complete combustion. So I would believe that some of these molecules are also broken down to the basic components of hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, etc. And that's why when you look at the exhaust, it's like that. It's pure air, basically. You don't see anything because it's a complete burn. And another effect that you see on these engines is that it's a cold process. So if you hold your hand on the exhaust, for instance, it's not hot. Like if you have a moped or you run an engine, it gets really hot. And in this case, it doesn't. It gets a little warm, but it doesn't get hot. Yeah.
Are there, to your knowledge, any place on the planet that are running Stanley Meyer's concept these days? Are there anybody who has replicated it and made it run?
There is, as far as in a car itself, I haven't heard of anybody. But I know that there is other people that claim that they have cars running on the principle of Stan Meyer, but I haven't been able to verify it. So that's pretty much all I know.
What about the patent? There was not so long ago, there was a story out that the patent was going to get into commercial production, but then later on the family withheld it. again, so they wouldn't give it up. Is there any news on that?
The patent, you mean Stan Meyer's patents? That somebody was doing what?
The family, I believe, holds the patent, right?
Actually, I'm not so sure if they hold the patent, but he was still married at the time, and so some of the stuff went to his wife. And this could be true. I mean, I really honestly don't know as far as what happened with that. I know that his brother, Stephen, was trying to come up with something similar, and he was involved with a company called Exogen in Canada that has also worked on different things and even referred to Stan's patents. And as far as I know, most of his patents by now has expired, except for a few maybe that has been refused. So most of that is in the open domain right now, as far as I know. No more questions? Okay. Well, then I think we'll end at that note. And if somebody has some more questions, I'm going to be available out there and answer it then. All right. Thank you.